I'd like to call this meeting to order and have a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Davis, the roll call, please.
Dr. Bruno?
Here.
Mr. Brown?
Present.
Mr. Johnson?
Present.
Dr. Kane?
Here.
Dr. Mograph?
Here.
Mr. Morell? Ms. Noe?
Here.
Mr. O'Brien?
Here.
Mr. Baum?
Here.
And Jim O'Meara?
Here.
Chris Arnett?
Here.
Warren Earl?
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Davis, can you read the New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law Statement?
New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law, an act to ensure the right of the public to advance notice and attend meetings in public body. Any business that may ever interest is discussed or acted upon. In accordance with the provisions of the Act, Montville Township Board of Education approved this meeting. Notice of the meeting can be posted in the Montville Municipal Building, all Montville Public Schools, Montville Public Library, Montville Township Board of Education Administrative Office Building, Montville Public School website, and advertised in the Daily Record.
Thank you. I see Grace and Tasneem are both here this evening. Do you have a report for us?
Yes. So the girls softball team won against Morris Hills with a score of 17-0 this past weekend. The team will play at Fresh Symphony this Thursday. The boys lacrosse team has a 5-9 record and played today against Chatham. They will play again this Friday at home against Morris Knowles. The baseball team is 8-8 and hopes to improve their record in a game against Persephone Hills this Friday at the high school. The girls lacrosse will play their final 6 games at home, and the next one is tomorrow at 4. The golf team competed at a tournament last week, and Tyler McKay shot 87, Zach Ward shot 89, Luke Schatzberg shot 91, and Miles Johnson shot 97.
The high school will be offering the opportunity for students who are 18 or will be 18 in the next coming months to register to vote for upcoming elections. Speaking of elections, student elections are coming up within the next couple of weeks, and the elections will be held on June 2nd. Senior breakfast is May 27th. Nearly 300 members of the senior class will be in attendance, and the seniors will travel to the Crystal Plaza in the morning to enjoy breakfast and also entertainment from an hypnotist. Mrs. Flug and Mr. Mensch will be hosting our annual Raku Clay Firing. This event is for students in the higher level ceramics 2 and 3 classes, and these students will be given the ability to fire their pieces in a different way than the traditional kiln.
Thank you very much, ladies. Any questions or comments from board members?
Yeah. Back on this Sunday, I talked to a woman who said she was going to be here actually Wednesday to register students. Is that your understanding, Grace, tomorrow?
Yeah, there was an announcement this morning. I'm pretty sure it was this week.
Oh, yeah, they're gonna start registering on Wednesday.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, ladies. Now, we normally would move on to the superintendent's report. Do you have something?
Well, I do have a couple things to comment on. First of all, I wanted to thank Austin Thompson and his team, the administrators and the teachers, for a very successful park implementation. Administration, I should say, this spring, considering the magnitude of the testing that goes on, it all went very smoothly overall. So that doesn't happen without a lot of work and planning and attention to detail. So I want to thank everyone involved with that. There was an article in the paper today, Governor Christie seeking some funding for school districts to do lead testing. I did want to report to the board and the public that we have done some preliminary testing of our own. We had some sampling done in all of our schools, and the results came back extremely positive in terms of there not being. There was only one sample that had just a trace amount of lead, and it was just barely above the minimum detection level for the laboratory instrument that they used to do that measurement, and it was well below what they call the action level that the EPA has determined. So We're in good shape. We're waiting to see what the legislature or the governor is going to move forward in terms of what other requirements there might be for school districts in terms of that testing. But for the moment, I feel very comfortable that the water that's in all seven of our schools is, does not present a problem for our staff or our students. I also wanted to note that the Cedar Hill School Diversity Committee has been selected as a 2016 Promising Practice by Character.org. They've been to the board before. We know that they are a high-functioning group in terms of character education. We're very proud of them for achieving that honor. I do believe it's October that there'll be a recognition event for them. I believe it's in Washington, D.C. So we congratulate those folks at Cedar Hill. It's a wonderful accomplishment. And I did want to note that one of our LaSalle teachers, Marissa Castromoda-Loss, was notified that she has been awarded a $10,000 Frederick Hip grant through NJEA for a STEM PALS project that she had proposed. So that is really a substantial grant for LaSalle, and we're very grateful and looking forward to watching the implementation of that project as well. Those are the things that I wanted to be sure to convey to the board tonight.
Thank you. Any board comments or questions? So with respect to, all of our elementary schools are wonderful in this case. Congratulations and kudos to Cedar Hill. With respect to the lead testing, there is a possibility that there will be dollars coming through to townships, possibility or...
From where?
From the state, apparently.
The governor has requested the legislature to fund this to the tune of $10 million. So
for the entire
state. So first thing that needs to happen is that funding needs to be authorized, and then there needs to be guidelines in terms of what the testing requirements are for districts and how local school districts can actually access some of that funding. None of that has been, I don't know if it's been developed, but certainly has not been shared with the school districts yet. So we'll certainly keep tuned for any developments in that area.
Very well.
Yeah, I read that the $10 million was just for the testing, mm-hmm. not for any remuneration. Remuneration.
For the actual testing itself.
Yeah.
Remedial.
That's how I read it.
Right, I agree. That's
hopefully,
my understanding as well.
Okay, thank you, Renee. We're going to alter the course of the schedule a little bit, and we're going to move forward. There will be a budget presentation, but we're going to delay on that for a few moments and move forward in the agenda. Mr. Tevis, do you have any business administrator's report?
No, I do not.
Are there any committee reports?
Yeah.
Mr. Graff.
Finance Committee met last Wednesday. Those in attendance were myself, Dr. King, Dr. Borlino, and Mr. O'Brien, along with Mr. Tevis, Dr. Robitar, Diane Maggiarone, and Steve Toth. Our attorney was there for a short part of the program. Basically, we were getting notification that all of our facility projects for 15-16 and 14-15 will be completed hopefully by June 1st. There were two or three outstanding. We are still attempting to get the money due to us from the state in the amount of approximately $188,000 for the 2001 referendum. Mr. Tevis has assured us that there's one piece of information lacking, and that if we have any problems, that he'll be contacting legislators to see if they can enhance us in getting the money that is due to us. We all know about the fire over Woodmont School. As Dr. Robitar reported last time, school was opened on Wednesday for the youngsters. Information to our insurance carrier. We don't have all of the bills yet, but once we have that, we will be getting reimbursed. There is a $10,000 deductible that we have to pay. Some of our extended school routes for the summer are going to have to be rebid. We're receiving RFP for custodial operations shortly. also administration recommended for project graduation, as we did last year, that we subsidized project graduation, and we would be paying for the buses to take the seniors from the high school over to Livingston, Short Hills, well, west, Northville Avenue, I guess it is, and that would be an amount of approximately $1,800, not to exceed it. Those of you that have been reading all of the newspapers indicated project graduation is having a lot of fundraisers, and it's a very worthwhile event, and we're happy to be able to participate. That's about it.
Thank you, Mr. Farrell. Any other committee reports?
CIP meeting, May 11th.
May 11th. Any delegates, liaisons?
May I just remind you from the last meeting, New Jersey School Board is having their delegate assembly on May 14th. I cannot attend. I would encourage anyone, please. It's very important. It's the policy setting meeting that the New Jersey School Board conducts twice a year, oftentimes. The resolutions that really drive decisions that New Jersey School Board makes are made in these meetings. So it's very important for every school district to be represented. Every school district gets a vote. So we should be there to cast our vote. It's on
Saturday.
Middlesex County. I think it's at Mercer County Community College.
Yeah.
And then on May 19th, Morris County School Board is conducting their last meeting of the year. It's a celebration of Morris school districts. There will be two school districts putting on programs that they've developed, both in Riverdale and Kinnelon. Board members will receive certain recognition for meeting requirements for certificated board member, master board member, certified board leader, and there'll be awards as well for years of service, and I believe our own Mr. Grau will be receiving an award for 20 years of service to public schools.
Thank you, Mr. Dear.
Yeah, I actually, those meetings are great meetings. If I were not going to be on an airplane myself, I would definitely be going, both for the content, but also to honor Mr. Grau. I hope that some board members, even administrators, were able to be there, because 20 years of service is quite a milestone. So congratulations, Mr. Grau. Any other delegate liaison, PTC liaisons?
Yes. Hillville's going to be having their treks this Friday. I believe it's 6 to 8. And it's fun for the kids to promote the products that they're coming up with and selling and just be a good time.
Thank you.
Mustang meeting tomorrow.
Mustang meeting tomorrow night. Any additional reports? While we're waiting for our laptop and our presentations just about ready, I wanted to ask for any public participation for items on the agenda. Seeing as there is none, can we? Let's move ahead with the budget presentation. At this point in time, I'll turn things over to our superintendent, Dr. Grovetar, and our business administrator, Mr. Tears, for a budget presentation, the beginning of the budget presentation.
Okay. We have, over the last 3 or 4 months, made presentations on the budget several times. We have not made presentations the last two board meetings simply because there really had not been any changes to the tentative budget that was approved by the board in March for submission to the county superintendent. That budget was approved, it was advertised, and we are going to present that information yet again tonight. I'll begin by giving you some of the highlights, nothing new again, and then I will turn things over to Mr. Tevis for some more of the detail in terms of numbers and tax impact and such. So we're very excited that the proposed 2016-17 budget maintains our current level of staffing and programs. We are also going to maintain all of our present extracurricular activities, our clubs and our athletics. We have included the implementation of a new elementary ABA program that's for some of our special education students. We have an early age program currently at the moment, and as those students are aging up, we will be moving that program to the next level to allow them to continue to be educated here in our very own district. We have talked in our previous meetings about the expansion of the world language program at the middle school level. We will be providing that expansion to include a full year of world language study at the seventh grade level. We will also be doing a full implementation of the iReady program. That's a diagnostic software program for language arts and mathematics instruction. In terms of some of the highlights of the expansion of program, we are adding some new elective courses at the high school. We will be adding an AP art history course, a Spanish culture and communication course, and fashion marketing as an elective. In terms of technology, we are looking to replace smart boards, not necessarily with that same technology, but with something a little bit more state-of-the-art. But the smart boards have reached their end of useful life, so we need to upgrade that technology. We are also looking to replace teacher laptops. Again, the technology that we have currently has been out there for a number of years, is approaching the end of its useful life. And we are continuing with the purchase of Chromebook and Chromebook carts throughout the district. We see the teachers using that technology on a daily basis, and obviously it serves as the primary vehicle for the PARC testing as well, so it has a dual function. I'll turn things over to Mr. Tevis and have him walk us through some of the capital initiatives and get into a little bit more of the nitty-gritty in terms of the actual numbers.
Thank you, Dr. Rosar. Okay, again, this is rehashing what we have presented a number of times throughout this budget season. There were no changes made to this budget whatsoever between the time that it was preliminarily adopted and submitted to the County Executive Superintendent of Schools for review and approval. The budget resolution is before the board this evening is exactly the same as the one that was adopted tentatively. That being said, I'm just going to focus on some of the larger capital initiatives. And again, I want to point out, as I do at the beginning of all these presentations, some of these slides can be a little tedious, if you will, especially the financial ones, some fine print. And I'm going to encourage everyone to go to the district website tomorrow. All of our budget presentations, including this one, are posted there, along with our user-friendly budget will be posted there as well. That being said, in the high school, we're one of the larger initiatives that we had been looking at was brick repointing and roof replacement. We're currently potentially holding that for now. Financing Facilities Committee is reviewing some of the larger projects and a potential alternative way to go with that. So we'll be more on that in a future meeting. We have some items such as maintenance items that we do need to keep moving with, such as a purchase of a truck, things like that. We are going to be moving forward plans at this point, moving forward with parking lot repairs at Lazar Middle School and upgrading the tech lab. At the Valley View School, we're going to be replacing some playground slides and moving forward with replacing blinds and putting some signage in. It's part of our safety and security initiatives. At the William Mason School, again, we're looking at a potentially roof replacement project. This is one of our larger ones. Again, this is one of those projects that we're potentially looking at an alternative method of funding, so we'll be more on that in the future. Woodmont School, we're looking to do some window repairs, we're moving forward with that, and we'll be planning on relining the middle and lower parking lots this summer as well. In terms of capital maintenance issues, district-wide technology, a number of initiatives our technology managers requested that we put into this budget. Such as wireless projection equipment, replacement of teacher laptops, purchase of additional Chromebooks, and new carts. And district-wide, we're looking at some parking lot curving, macadam and sidewalk paving repairs. This is an ongoing maintenance initiative that we do put into the budget pretty much almost every year to keep up with our facilities. We do have, you know, seven buildings, we have eight, and we count four buildings, that we do, you know, want to keep them in good order, working with for the community, because they're not just used by, obviously, by the staff and students in the school, but by the community at large. It's important to keep up a good face, and we're going to have problems in the community down the road, just to be glad. And moving forward, some of the financial highlights, you know, budget constraints, for example. This is a relatively large school district budget, because some school buildings, as I noted. Salaries and health benefits of any public school system typically are approximately, in our case, 76% of the district's annual budget. That's pretty much the average for a public school. Excuse me, our salaries are increasing by 2.5% in the current 2015-2016, and will again in the 16-17 school year for a negotiated agreement with teachers. Appropriations for health benefit premiums have increased about 6%. Excuse me, the impact of greater than 2% increase on such a substantial portion of the budget is significant, and it limits the potential to expand existing programs and introduce new ones. So it's always an ever-tightening, race, if you will, superintendent, myself, the administration, to get as much bang for the buck as we possibly can. Again, I would urge everyone to go to the website, and again, we did have some handouts as well of presentation slides, and just breakdown of some of the larger areas of the revenue section, such as your local tax impact, state aid, federal aid, tuitions, so on and so forth. Both in a chart form and in a spreadsheet form. We then do the same thing on the expenditure level. Again, it's a roughly $74 million operating budget. And this particular on page 11 does a nice job of really breaking out the major areas of expense within the school district budget. And I urge you to take a look at that. And we're just going, please, by all means, I do urge the public. Some people do actually give me a form, which is nice. They call my office or send me an email question. And I'm very, very happy to answer any questions anyone might have. Again, we're in a rather busy pie graph here on the expenditure side, but again, it'll be the general flair.
Details.
Yes, it certainly is. On page 13 of the presentation, basically we just give a nice multi-year comparison of just the increase in your local tax rate. If you look at that revenue pie chart, you can see that that revenue pie chart shows that the biggest piece of the pie, which is almost roughly 90% the entire budget, is funded through local taxes, the local tax levy. So this particular slide here shows the increase in that local tax levy from 1 year to the next in the last 2 years. You can see it's been staying constant at 2%. That's a cap that's in place currently in New Jersey. So you scratch your head and you say, wait, didn't you just tell us that our salaries are increasing by 2.5% and our insurance premiums are up 6%? Yes, that's true, and that's why it's becoming more and more difficult and more of a challenge, you know, for the superintendent, administration, myself to present a budget. But we have, you know, we get creative as you possibly can, and we move forward. Excuse me. One of the ways that we do this is by use of shared services, and we are increasing this every single year. We get into cooperatives with transportation, with purchasing custodial supplies, maintenance supplies, just even shared services in regards to technology. Technology managers are really big up for our internet and our wide area network services to save the district a lot of money, hundreds of thousands of dollars. So these are ways that we're trying to, you know, get around that, to stay within that 2% cap, stay within. State aid comparison just gives you a quick look, again, multi-year comparison of state aid increases or state aid levels of state aid funding that we've had for the last 3 years. And page 16 is one of my favorite slides. We need a magnifying glass. But this is for those accountants in the front. And again, I would urge you, know, if you get time, go on to the district website and blow it up. And again, I'm urging, if you have questions on it, please by all means. It does give you a nice breakout of different sections of the budget over multi-years, you know, essentially your fund balance, your local tax levy, use the tax percentage at the bottom. So we try to give you as much information as possible. And figure a little more is always a little bit better than less in these cases. Proposed budget final term highlights, just to sum things up real quick. The budget does not exceed the 2% local tax levy cap. Stay within it again, once again. We have a general fund expenditure budget increase of less than 2%, 1.39%. General fund operating budget expenditures increased from last year to this year. But superintendent still managed to introduce new educational facility initiatives, despite staying within that 2% cap. The last few pages, just again, sum up basically the exact same thing that I understand with detailed charts. At that point, I think I'll turn it back over to Dr. Rothar if there's anybody has any questions.
Yeah, I guess the only other thing that we wanted to highlight here is on this particular page is the actual tax impact. And for the average home, which is assessed at $528,092, we're looking at an overall increase for the year of $139. That's, you know, what the budget increase represents. So when you take it down to the very local resident level. And then, yes, we are, I guess we would first entertain any questions that the board members may have. And then, since we already did the public portion of the meeting, we could reopen things for any public comments specifically on the budget.
So any comments or questions from the board?
Just a comment. I think going back to 2006 or so, I think the only two people who are on this side of the table, they're still here now, myself and Steve Edelstein. And I kind of remember those days of my first budget. I kind of remember that the budget was something like 6.3% increase. And on top of that, they had two second questions, one for busing, one for the turf. And the board at that time was trying to sell a but they're trying to sell about 9-point-something% increase to the public, which the public rejected and ended up being a mess. But then when they changed the cap to 4%, everyone thought the world was coming to an end, and then it went down to 2%, and that's where we are now. So, you know, you guys, you know, Jim, Renee, all the people in central office, you guys are doing it for years, just, you know, compliments to you doing the most you can with what little you have to work.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Yeah.
Dave?
Yeah, I'll just make a comment that what we're seeing with the 2% tax cap, again, I was worried about this many years ago. It's eventually going to end up squeezing us. Some school districts in the state have already felt the squeeze. We're not able in this budget to introduce new programs. I would be very concerned that in the future we're going to continue being squeezed as the cost of our benefits keeps rising, as the cost of just maintaining what we have here increases. I hope that the governor will maybe increase our aid. I won't hold my breath. But I do have to applaud the administration for their hard work on this budget, and I've been very impressed with the budgets I've seen over the years, how well they've been able to put together a good budget for our school system.
Thank you,
Dave. Did I just ask a question?
Microphone.
I noticed that the, and maybe you can
Mike, you got a little, put your mouth actually.
Maybe you can just give me a little rationale here. I know, I see on the pie chart, the special ed costs are about 11, almost 12%. So the state aid, they're not giving us the aid as much as they want. What happened? Just in this, the state budget, why are they cutting that?
There's no guarantee with this. I mean, we do get some direct state aid called special education, but it basically is all mixed in with the general state. The other component that we get is something referred to as extraordinary aid. And that's a moving target. We've been doing relatively well, but certainly by no means come close to covering our not even close. But it is something, and that's, there's no guarantee with extraordinary ratings, we've been doing well with it, relatively speaking, but it could go away.
So the number that you have there, the special education aid, 1,000,004, are we pretty, we're not totally sure we're going to get that, or we...
It's going to start, yeah, we're confident we will, but I mean, there's no guarantee, there's not a guarantee.
Which is less than last year, but it's not based on the number of students, right?
Well, the thing we have to keep in mind, too, is that when the current funding formula was put in place, they ran it the first year, and then every year since then, we've been in a hold harmless situation. So they run the formula every year, and they give that to us as part of our state aid pronouns. We're actually entitled by formula to far more aid than what we receive. But because the state is in this hold harmless scenario, there really hasn't been, what they do, as Jim indicated, our overall bottom line has pretty much remained the same. What they do is they manipulate the subcategories from year to year to get us to pretty much the same point. So this year they introduced a new category. And that probably is why we see the decrease in special ed, because overall we're still getting the same amount of aid. They've just recategorized it.
Our district was recategorized.
No, the category of aid.
Aid, okay.
Right. So, and this is the smoke and mirrors kind of deal that we.
That's what it sounds like.
Yeah, that we deal with, because by and large, the aid to districts like Montville has not changed substantially over the last 4 years.
Since it was cut.
Yeah.
That's right. There was in 2010, we used to receive $3.2 million a year, and we haven't seen anything even close to that since. The amount of dollars year over year that this district has not received from state aid is beyond substantial. I wouldn't want to float it over out there without calculating it.
So our taxpayers got it. Come on, we've got to...
Our taxpayers are bearing more of the burden, absolutely, as we try to restrict costs, which has an impact on the budget.
And just want to be clear on that.
Yeah, and I just wanted to thank the two of you and the entire administration, at the school level too, everyone helped with this budget. Thank you. If there are no other questions, I did want to open it up if there aren't any questions from the public about the budget. Seeing as there are none, we'll move forward with the action part of the agenda. I'd like to entertain a motion to approve items I through O.
So moved.
The revised budget.
Thank you.
The revised
budget resolution.
Thank you.
Someone
move
that? Carmen Lopez.
Yes.
Carmen who?
You said
it. I did. I guess so. I'm having so much fun.
Any board member questions, comments on the minutes? Item I. Item J, administrative.
Just that I'm really pleased that Dr. Rowe Carr is pursuing J3, participation in the Sustainable Jersey School Certification Program. Thank you.
Karen, I want to comment on that. We read it when you were reading over Ms. Tita's budget, some of the shared services items. If you recall, a few years ago, we joined services forces with the town with the garbage and recycling collection program. Dr. Rothbard, well before you were here, we initiated some solar programs as well, utilizing solar energy in the school district. And so this is a very timely addition, and thank you for bringing it forth and moving it forward. Sustainable energy. Any other comments, questions about item J, item K? L, personnel, item M, N, or O. Roll call, please, Mr. Pierce.
Ms. Miller.
Yes.
Mr. Brown.
Yeah.
Dr. Corleone.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Dr. Mulder.
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien.
Aye.
Mr. Brown.
Yes.
Dr. King.
Yes.
Motion's passed.
Any old business?
Just wanted to remind seven people here that we changed our board meeting time to 7:45. I noticed on the marquee at Town Hall, they had a mistake here. They said 7:30, but it's 7:45 from now on for the public.
Thank you, Charlie. Any general board comments or new business?
I wanted to bring up briefly, originally I mentioned on the aside that about the there are a number of articles in the newspaper recently about football schedules and the problems that the NJSIA are facing getting all schools. There are certain schools that will not adhere to the schedules as proposed. And, you know, I was going to talk more about that, but I was thinking that since the Mustang meeting is tomorrow night, I'll try to get information from the athletic director who would be up on that and try to forward it to the board and maybe bring it up at a future meeting when we have more information.
Thank you.
But I am concerned about this issue of some schools refusing to play their schedule, and one or two of them, at least one, may be a school that had been on our schedule.
But sure. These public or private schools?
Well, it really has to do with the private schools who were going to be put together in a conference, and some of them don't want to play each other now. And we do play, at least, or have been playing, at least one of those schools. And of course, the topic they keep going back to is safety. Those schools that won't play are using safety as an issue in refusing to play certain schools. And I'm concerned about the safety of our own students, okay, and who we play. But I think what I'll do is try to get more information at the Mustang meeting, and I'll put it in my report if I can get some information about it.
Yes. Do we know who we're playing yet next year?
Well, I think I'm not the expert, maybe.
It can wait for your next.
Well, I think we have is it called tentative?
I think we do have a tentative.
Tentative. But that's the thing, it could change based on these events that are taking place within the NJSIA. Here at this very late date. It's very late to be working on a schedule for next fall at this point. So that's why I am concerned. The safety issue, we were going to play the whole topic. But I'll try to find out more.
Could we get a copy of that tentative round?
Yep, I will get that for you, absolutely.
Mr. Plum?
Yeah, I thought I remember, maybe I'm misinformed. I thought that whole thing with the change in the conference, I thought the state, I don't remember, I guess it was the NJSIA rejected that whole thing, or was it the Department of Education? Somebody rejected it. I thought we were back to square one on that. No,
okay, sure.
I don't
remember. Yeah, I thought the NJSIA approved it and it was rejected by the Commissioner of Education.
Right.
Sure.
Right.
So we are back where we started.
Yes.
I think that's exactly the reason why some schools are saying they're not going to play.
Any other items, general board comments? Then I'll open the floor for any public participation. Seeing as there's none, I'd like to entertain a motion to adjourn. Thank you. That was you, Charlie. Second.
I think Charlie.
Thank you.